Okay, so for today's lecture, we are going to focus on plant containment. So under some circumstances, you may have to resort to plant containment. The term plant containment pertains to containing a plant or germplasm in a facility, okay, and preventing access to that facility from the external environment. So you don't permit that plant to be shifted out from that environment until it's basically resolved to be free of pathogen or free of genetically modified material. Okay, so why does this concept of plant containment come into the picture today? This is because certain processes have necessitated the need to contain plants. For example, germplasm is imported. You import germplasm from another country. Along with that germplasm, for instance, you bring planting material. It will carry its own repertoire of pathogens. It may contain fungi, it may contain insects, or it may contain some element which, when you transfer into your environment, they will have an impact on the crops. Okay? And this can lead to economic losses. That is one aspect of containment. The second reason why we need to contain is because of legal requirements such as the Malaysian biosafety laws. For instance, if you genetically modify a plant, prior to release, you need to obtain permission. So we can't basically transfer a plant from a laboratory into the field directly. We need to first confine it or contain it within a facility where we carry out the requisite due diligence. We should ensure, for instance, that the germplasm from that plant will not be transferred into endemic crops. Sometimes plants may have pollen which will be transferred to land races or the crops which are extant in that particular region, and then you will have a hybrid. Okay? There's a likelihood that this hybrid may be genetically modified, which means it may contain pollen from the GM plant as well as the traditional germplasm, and then you'll have problems with regard to the legal aspect of breeding. For instance, local farmers can resort to legal action over your crop because they will say that our crop is organic and yours is genetically modified, ours is traditional, and you have interfered with our traditional process. So that's the reason why you need to resort to containment. So in addition to the science behind it, we also have to look at the legal aspect of compliance with national laws. Okay. So, the objective of this module is to introduce you to the concept of plant containment, to introduce you to relevant situations where you may need to apply plant containment, because plant containment is an expensive process. It involves facilities, it involves personnel, and it involves training. So in some instances, there is no need for containment. For instance, if it's a native plant, and then you cultivate it, and you don't carry out any modification, there is no need for containment. However, when it's a new novel variety or an imported variety, you need to resort to containment. So there are procedures associated with containment which we need to adhere to. This may be national or international procedures, and we also have design considerations. So at the end of this module, I will introduce you to a conceptual transgenic containment facility. That's the design concept on which our facility is based. We have a transgenic containment facility, so it's based on that concept. Okay, so these are your learning outcomes. You should be able to describe situations in which you need to apply containment within the context of objective number two, or learning outcome number two, which is the relevant national laws, okay, which is pertain to living modified organisms. And you should be able to understand national policies and guidelines and develop a conceptual design. So these are the key learning outcomes. Okay, but one of the outcomes which I like to emphasize is the process of risk assessment. When you refer to two, learning outcome number two, you actually have to go through a process of risk assessment, risk mitigation, and performance assessment. This process forms the basis of biological risk management. We'll go through that during the course of the lecture. So when do we need to resort to containment? As I explained to you, one of the aspects is transgenic plants. That's a definite area in which you need to resort to containment. Okay, sometimes the manufacturers or producers of genetically modified plant may not want their germplasm to escape, not because it's a problem to the local varieties, but because it was a patent. For instance, you have developed a synthetic gene, and if that transgene escaped, somebody can copy that gene and they can produce a variant of it. So this is why the legal aspect comes into the picture. It's the legal protection of the environment as well as the company which produces that particular germplasm. So when we refer to containment, there are terms associated with containment. The first term is primary containment. So assuming that barrier, the rectangle, is the germplasm which you need to contain. Primary containment refers to the protection of the personnel. So that's primary. So you are the personnel associated with the germplasm. For instance, the germplasm may be modified. For instance, a plant modified to carry transgenic virus. Okay, so it's a virus. So you need to protect yourself from that virus. Maybe the virus is a human pathogen. So you need to have primary containment. So anything that which protects you from the what is known as the biological organism is termed as primary containment. So primary containment can pertain to the usage of personal protective equipment. For instance, your respirator, your masks, your gloves, all these are primary containment. In addition to that, we have what we term as secondary containment. Secondary containment pertains to the environment. So in order to have a watertight containment facility, you have to ensure that you have primary containment which will protect the personnel, and secondary containment which protects the environment. So secondary containment generally refers to the structure. For example, our transgenic plant containment facility is a facility. So it's a physical structure, it's an engineering control which protects the environment from any pollen or any pathogens which may be released as a consequence of accidents. So when you have a breach of this containment, for example, there's a barrier. For example, there may be a natural disaster and your glass panel breaks, your glass house. So you have a breach of containment. Then you have to resort to certain measures to contain that breach. Okay? So it may involve, for example, notification, informing the authorities that you have a breach. It may involve collecting all the plants within that radius of their facility and decontaminating. So there are various procedures which need to be followed when you have a breach of containment. So you have primary containment, secondary containment, and you can have a breach of containment when any of these barriers have been broken down. Okay, these are the key definitions. So it protects laboratory users. Primary containment protects laboratory users, and secondary containment protects the environment from the biological agent. Okay, in this case, the biological agent is the plant which is genetically modified or which has been imported and may contain pathogens. Okay, these are the situations which require containment. You have genetically modified plants, imported planting material, plants which have been cultured in vitro in the tissue culture system and which you won't need to transfer into the field. Challenge test. Challenge test refers to a situation in which you want to test a plant for its ability to resist pathogens, for instance, fungus. In this case, you have your plant in a contained facility and you expose it to the fungus, a pure culture of the fungus, and you test for the resistance. So in this case, you have to be careful with reference to the fungus. You should ensure the fungus is not transferred out of the facility. So in this case, you need to resort to containment. And the fifth one is control breeding experiments. Sometimes you want to create a hybrid plant. So you have crossbred two pure varieties to create a hybrid. However, you want to ensure that no external pollen comes into the system. So in this case, you have to resort to containment. So containment doesn't necessarily pertain to genetically modified plant. It also pertains to controlled breeding experiments as well. Okay. Genetically modified plants can have an impact on pollinators. For instance, if you have insecticidal proteins in certain plants, you have modified them to carry proteins which are insecticidal. If these pollen escapes and contaminates local plants, what are known as local land races, there's a likelihood that those plants may also carry this insecticidal protein genes, and they can disrupt the local ecology, which is why we need to have stringent regulations with regard to genetically modified organisms. In some instances, you may need to quarantine imported planting material. For instance, if you import oil palm saplings or oil palm seedlings from West Malaysia or from Indonesia, they may carry with them pathogens. Okay, these pathogens may not manifest themselves at earlier stages. They may manifest themselves at later stages. So in order to ensure that these pathogens do not propagate through your ecosystem, you need to contain these plants for a limited period of time. And then you need to analyze. For example, you can do molecular tests to determine whether they are carrying pathogens. So if they carry pathogens, you basically restrict their import. So in future instances, you can screen for those pathogens. Okay. Plants developed in vitro may also be subject to containment if they sometimes contain, for instance, plants which are developed in vitro are weaker, may be weakened due to the process of in vitro cultivation. When you plant them in the field, they are likely to be infected with pathogens more easily as compared to the traditional varieties. So in this case, you may have to resort to containment to protect the plant from the pathogens. In some cases, for example, in the case of banana, which has been tissue cultured, a large number of banana plants may get infected with virus because you are using monoculture. So if you resort to tissue culture, you need to ensure that the plants are resistant before you transfer them in the field. Otherwise, you will not only create a problem for your crop, you will create a problem for neighboring crops as well, your neighborhood farming communities. Then you have controlled breeding experiments. So sometimes farmers want to develop what are known as determinate hybrids. Determinate hybrids is where you have two pure parental genotypes and you develop a hybrid. So in this case, they are very particular with regard to pollen coming in. They don't want other pollen to come in. So in this case, we have controlled breeding experiments. So these experiments are usually done under containment, which is why what are known as determinate hybrid crops are very expensive, because they require extensive usage of facility for development. You can't have other pollen coming in. You know, if you have other pollen coming in, you will have a problem with the output, the seed. So when you have a F1 determinate hybrid variety, which is advertised by the producer, it has to contain the germplasm from the two original parents. You can't have external pollen coming in. Okay, so that's why the farmer pays more for these determinate hybrids, so he gets a uniform crop. And sometimes we do challenge tests. Challenge tests, for example, if you have a particular variety of fungus, for example, rice blast, you may have a fungus which you isolate from the field, and then you want to test these new varieties of rice. You import different seeds from different countries and you want to test which is the best strain for growing locally. But before that, you need to subject it to pathogen test, right? So you do a challenge test, which means you contain the plants in a facility and then you subject them to the fungus. You culture, pure culture the fungus, and you test which variety is the most suited for with regard to that fungus. So the one which resists the fungus, you can transfer into your field. Okay, so this is a challenge test which require containment. Because if you have, for instance, in a containment facility, you can control the pathogen. But suppose you have a breach, right? The pathogen can spread all over. and can then spread to the local land races and local crops. Okay, so that's the basis for containment.